Okay, so I'm Drew Fustini. I'm one of the board members of the BeagleBoard.org Foundation. Jason Kridner is co-founder of BeagleBoard.org Foundation and the BeagleBone. And Robert Nelson is the man behind our Debian images and a bunch of other of the things on the software side that make it really useful and easy to use.
Patcher of patches.
Yes. So this is the first time, and I think we've all three been at ELC together. So it was great to be able to get together and have a birds of a feather about BeagleBone and BeagleBoard. And thanks to Frank for rescheduling this so we aren't up against the other BoFs, because I think we definitely have a lot of people that probably also be on in the device tree BoF tomorrow evening, I think.
Tonight?
Yeah, at 7.
Okay. All right. So put together a few slides, but mainly the point of this is to have a discussion with y'all and see what you're interested in, what questions you might have. So one of the things to keep in mind is tomorrow morning we do have two talks. Jason's giving a talk, I'm giving a talk. So tomorrow we have a talk in the morning. Jason's giving a talk about educational robotics, and I'm giving a talk about Google Summer of Code. And we also will have the BeagleBoard X15 and the BeagleBoard Blue at the technical showcase tomorrow night. So I think the first thing I wanted to go over is we kind of have a nice ecosystem now of different BeagleBones, which you may or may not be aware of all the different ones. I don't know if you want to say anything about this, Jason. Kind of have a
So there's a logo licensing program. So a lot of people don't know. BeagleBoard.org Foundation is a nonprofit foundation. You know, for the details, we're actually still working on our tax exempt status, but hope to get that straightened out soon. But it is a nonprofit. We do fund the foundation through royalties of the logos, so there's trademarks. We do everything as open source hardware. You know, we try to use open source, you know, bits anywhere we can. I think the only limitation is if you want to run 3D graphics, which we don't even like drive a lot of stuff towards the 3D graphics, especially on the BeagleBones. There's some closed source bits there. But we push all of our build scripts, so Robert maintains that all this stuff so that you can rebuild the images from scratch. And we try to support people helping us get code into mainline. So everything is open hardware. We make sure that we don't use chips that you can't get the documentation for, that you can't actually go to DigiKey or pick your favorite distributor here and actually buy the chips and make the boards yourselves. We've been doing things to try to make it easier and easier to clone. I think that's really different than a lot of other, low-cost educational Linux computers, right? So that's something that we do differently, and it's a part of we are. But we do need to try to do some things to fund activities with the foundation, and we do that through logo licensing. And so each of these different guys, if it's not a BeagleBoard.org product, the manufacturers of those, we don't have any manufacturing ourselves. Those get manufactured somewhere else. They pay a logo fee, and then all these other guys pay a logo fee in order to put the Beagle brand on their boards. And then we try to do quality control as we can manage.
As bugs get found, of course.
But of course, we listen, right? The community is the biggest source of quality control. We don't block negative comments. Right, with the coming through the mailing lists and coming through the IRC channels, the only thing we've ever had to block is like real hate speech, like religious hate speech. But if you mention competitors' products, you say something negative, we keep that out there, right, for all time, and so we try to be accountable to the community.
The other, so I also have our two, so this is probably one of the more recent products people may or may not be aware of. This is the BeagleBone Black Wireless, and this was the first product that's using the Octavo system in package. So you'll notice that giant BGA there on the board integrates the processor and the DDR memory, power management, and a bunch of other passives. The nice thing about that frees up board space So this is actually a...
It's a six-layer board.
But it's done in Eagle.
It's done in Eagle. So you could do this very low cost. You could make modifications to it. There's 145 different components inside that package, including inductors and all the high-speed stuff that you don't have to worry about laying on your board. So a tool like Eagle could be used. Of course, we have folks working with KiCad doing derivative designs with this SIP as well. So we think this makes this a lot. This is what makes this special, is that people can actually go and make these different variations of their own open hardware.
And I just had for our technical showcase where we have two posters up. So come to the showcase and we'll talk more about BeagleBone Blue and X15.
Yeah, and this is private for our friend DA, right? So there's, I mean, this stuff all gets out there, but we try to be really open with our community. But the blue isn't, like, the details of that isn't really public information yet. Yet the source files are on GitHub. try to consolidate that in your mind. We do try to manage the brand. We do want to try to make news when this stuff comes out, right? So we don't want to be putting all your blogs and stuff now, so that the media feels like they're getting scooped. But if they just hung out and participated with the cool people, they know all about it.
So probably one of the topics that hopefully people in the room will have questions about, and Robert can speak about, is our Debian images. And what the current versions are, and what's coming up next. So did you want to say anything about this, Robert?
Sure, just that, especially anyone that's using any of the wireless devices, make sure you have one of the latest images. There's a couple issues on the November release, especially with Bluetooth. So otherwise, we try to have a full option for everyone, whether just standard IoT images or some kind of desktop or just a regular console, from the basically build anything.
Yeah, these are the two main ones we push out to the users. We ship with the LXQT image for the BeagleBone Black and all the boards that have HDMI interfaces, so they have a full desktop on them. And then for something like the green, the green wireless, we have an IoT image. We actually have a separate IoT image with a captive portal that Seed worked out.
They just have one extra package now, so that's it.
So it's just a one package delta, which is their captive portal page, which is it's kind of a nice tool, but it's a little bit
it takes a lot of resources.
Yep.
So I think
we got a question.
Oh,
here.
Yeah.
How many of these require 4 gigabytes and won't run on the Revision A hardware?
So the big one that requires 4 gigabytes is the LXQT image. That one's, I think it's shipping right now at 3.3 gigs, while the ILT will fit in a 2 gig image and the console will fit there. We do have a 2 gig image of the LXQT, but other than being built, it's not actually tested to see if it'll fit.
But it should work.
It should work. I haven't any complaints.
Feedback on the list. The big item that is the browser, Chromium,
yep.
takes
yep.
is it's like a 1 gig package in itself, right?
Yeah, it's mainline Chromium, so that's only on the 4 gig image. We stripped that out for the 2 gig one.
And the IoT, I think, is a useful thing for a lot of people. Like, I used to use the full desktop until you started doing the IoT, and I don't actually use the desktop. I just didn't want to have to install the packages that aren't on the console version.
Yeah.
I would almost just ship the IoT image, but it takes a long time for those that do want to install X to wait for all those packages to download. So
yeah.
Bill. Oh, and we need to give you a microphone.
Your LXQT image, is that Wayland or X?
It's still X, especially in Jesse. In Stretch, we're going to see what we can do. We have Wayland available, but we'll see.
And you do have Jesse Wayland builds, but not one of the standard build packages.
Yeah, it's not standard. The main goal of that was, since the SGX drivers we do have are EGL/Wayland, we could potentially actually have graphics on these, but it's not usable for users yet.
We did get an amazing user contribution of 2D graphics acceleration for X15 open source, so we're pretty excited about that. So we do now have 2D graphics acceleration within the X15 image.
So the future for our images is Debian 9, which is Stretch.
Yeah, and some of the big things that we're going to change, a lot of stuff we did in Jesse and Wheezy was for the old Angstrom group and all the defaults it did. So we're finally going to nuke the root password about being blank. And we're also disabling SSH access via root. So that's going to catch some users off guard. They actually have to type in the Debian username we've been using for 3 years now instead of just root. And we're also nuking the sudo don't ask for password option that we have set. Anyone who logs in as Debian currently, they can just type sudo in what they want and it doesn't ask for password. So we're finally getting our act together and cleaning up how messy your images will look for.
You don't consider this necessarily like real security, but it's baby steps towards real security. And if somebody wants to do a real security audit, that we're very open to working with folks on that.
Especially if they have patches.
Can you elaborate on the SSH access?
So right now, the current images, if you just do root at address, you log in, no password. So what we're changing, we disabled root over SSH, which actually is a Debian default. And when you're as root, you actually say if you want to be a serial or as a console window, you actually have to type in the password root instead of just hitting enter and going in.
Okay, so only root access if you disable root.
You'll still be able to Debian SSH Debian at, but then you're required to type in the password, which it prints on the screen for you.
So the bots have to be a little bit smarter. They actually have to grab the screen.
At least they have to be targeted bots. I mean, there was a botnet attack that went out back in like October or September last year.
That was the big one.
October against the DNS servers.
So a default BeagleBone would have participated in that. Because it went around and just tried to log in, like it did root. It would SSH into nodes that it found, and it would try root at port 22, password blank, and and then it had ARM binaries that it would use to propagate the attack. So if you put an unpatched BeagleBone on the internet, what were you thinking?
We know it's easy to plug it in, but
Yeah, it would have participated in that botnet, so at least this would get it off of that. It's at least patched enough to not do that.
And one of the later things that we've done lately is we're actually, for a long time, we used Pantel's device tree overlay patch for building the overlays. We're actually now fully on mainline DTC. So we've backported that to our 4.1, 4.4, and 4.9 kernel. So the DTC that's actually being built in the kernel is mainline DTC. So all the overlays are... We're thinking forward to move forward. We didn't backport to 3.8 though, so we still have two binaries.
Can you mention what's still missing from that? Pantel's
extra? Yeah, the whole cape overlay manager.
No, the fact you have to put in all the overlay, underscore, underscore, overlay, all that garbage by hand.
Yeah.
We will get rid of that.
Yeah, we will.
So he's saying that the mainline DTC requires you to do some extra content within your specify that it's overlay underscore underscore overlay underscore, right?
Yeah, that's going away.
Just since I know he wasn't on the microphone, I was just repeating the complaint.
And for Stretch, for planning, we're still thinking we'll probably end up just shipping 4.4 by default, but 4.9 is looking pretty good. There's a couple things we've left to do, such as testing, but got a question back here.
Thank you.
Well, I will document the three lines you need to re-enable that, so. Because it's going to be a frequently asked question.
Yeah, I mean, we know we're going to get hit by a lot of noobs with this. You know, I think, as Robert just said, it's like, we'll do it as long as I can blame you. And so that's blame me.
Yeah. So any questions? It's Jason.
It just, I get tired of going places and hearing, from security experts that we're part of the problem and not the solution. And it's like, okay, I'll start listening.
So the other big thing that we're doing here is, we is Maxine here by any chance?
Nope. Should go forward to the U-boot overlay?
Yeah, I was going to talk about that right here.
Yeah.
So Maxine did a nice thing for next chip when he got U-boot overlays working for that chip. And so device tree overlays can be done in U-boot, and we've kind of built on that process where right now you can, with one command in our boot unit environment, you can actually do U-boot overlays by default with our images. It doesn't support all devices quite yet, but it's getting there.
So I still think there's use cases for having runtime device tree management, right? So being able to on Beagles, being able to dynamically change the device tree at runtime, that's somewhat contentious. But at least, and so I still want to have the cape manager, but at least this actually eliminates the requirement for it for 95% of all your capes.
I mean, there's some devices that when we try to do it in kernel land, it just blows up, especially anything with video. So just pushing video to U-boot actually solves a couple of those problems, because there's a nice big race condition there.
I do find a lot of user error, and this is something I think needs to be worked on. If you mess up the environment variables in your boot environment, it won't boot, and, well, go find a serial cable, right? I don't think it's a problem for anybody here in this room, but for noobs, you know, it does get to be a challenge when their kernel doesn't boot and they have to get to the U-boot prompt.
And depending what version of U-boot's in the UMMC, it might load a flash file system so you can actually fix it.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, sometimes.
One of the thing is there's a bunch of hyperlinks in these slides, and they are on elinux.org right now in the ELC 2017 page, and they're also on the conference website. So if you want to click on any links in here and get to either the GitHub repos or eLinux wiki, there's links to various pages on there. You can do that. Did you want to talk about any of the syntax, Robert?
Sure, we'll talk about some of the syntax. Main thing is, with the old 3.8 kernel, you've always had disable EMMC, disable HDMI, and disable HDMI audio. For the overlays, we've added quick clicks for you to actually do the same exact thing. And we've also added the wireless option, because some boards, like the BeagleBone Green wireless, some of those pins are actually used by the cape. So the black wireless doesn't have that problem. But. And then we've always had, you could add load four capes. So we have four overrides. So if you have a cape that has a wrong firmware name or something, you can redefine it and load a different one. And then plus one more on top of that.
At this point, we're still not doing any EEPROM reading?
The first four, we're doing EEPROM reads.
Okay.
But it turns out not every cape has EEPROM.
Yeah.
And if it does, it was never written to. Small issues. And the goal of this, we don't have this completely done yet, but it'll load cape universal at the end too. So all of the config pin options will still work.
I think there's probably still some more granularity that needs to happen here, such that it'll load a helper. So thank you very much for helper functions, Pentelus. But for every pin that you could mux, I don't think that you could get into situations where it won't necessarily load the helper for it. So we want to have a helper for everyone so we can get back to where we were in 3.2 kernel land.
So I think one of the things, Robert, you had mentioned on the mailing list was for people to test out their capes with this?
Yeah, the main thing was, if you have a cape that, let's make sure it works. I mean, I got a bunch of capes, but there's so many in the field that have been built in the last 3 years. And this is a big migration from, well, we know it worked in the kernel, but does it work with overlays with U-boot? And one of the big things in U-boot, we wanted to detect the cape and say, okay, these pins are now can't be used. We have to redo that whole database.
How do we want people to communicate that? On the mailing list or?
Either the mailing list, by email, or by the GitHub account that this is on.
The BB overlay Git repo is where all the DTBs for the capes. So that's the BB.org overlays. Since really 90% of the cape support is just the DT overlay, this is where we're expecting all the cape support to be.
And right now, this supports 4.1 all the way to 4.10. So we've forward-ported most of the 3.8 capes, but we didn't have all of them to test. So that's mostly just user-tested boards, capes we had.
The thing that the wonderful thing to me about the having the overlays in U-boot is means you actually get on your LCD, you can actually see the boot screen now. So that's thank
and
you.
And that worked in 3.8, but has it worked since?
Yep.
So that's the end of the slides. So I was just hopefully this is some useful links for people. If you go to the slides, you can click on these. But do you have anything else, Robert, that or Jason, that people should maybe go to if there are any other useful links or anything like that? That we,
for information?
Yeah.
The board GitHubs, each one, there's a hardware GitHub for each of them. On some of them, I'm moving the system reference manuals into MediaWiki and using the GitHub Wiki. So starting with the BeagleBone Black, and contributions are welcome there. So the system reference manual at this point has been converted to MediaWiki. And just trying to make it better to get to that documentation online rather than this massive PDF, right, that you have to kind of go through today, right? That, you already have to go through a 3,000 page PDF for the technical reference manual for the processor. Do I want to go through another 300 pages for documentation on the board? Let's put it on a wiki and manage that content a little bit better. So, So there's more GitHubs there. If you go to the github.com/BeagleBoard, there's a number of useful repos there. So
yeah, pretty much everything we do is on GitHub. So if we're missing something, we obviously missed it then. So
that's kind of the end of the outline. Looks like we had a question out there somewhere? Or okay.
Lots of questions.
Somebody who's helped us get some good Debian patches upstream, thank you very much.
Okay. So, I'm Vagrant Cascadian. I work on Debian, and I've the U-boot maintainer, and I worked on helping getting BeagleBoard switched over to Debian. But there's also this divergence that's still there or still happening, and I don't know if there's some strategy or plan or way we could work together to reduce the divergence with mainline mainly, because then I can just pull it into Debian. And then I was also really curious of the overlay support. Is that with mainline U-boot, or is that with a patched U-boot, or these are questions I have.
Yeah. So when you're talking about divergence from mainline, are you talking about kernel, U-boot, or Debian?
Yes.
Yes.
So I'll start with the first one. With U-boot, Maxine did most of the work on that. So in mainline U-boot, you just have to enable a config and the overlays will work. The manager, however, was not there. And right now we have it's a work in progress patch. And that's one of the ones we leaked on here. It's like, here's the current version that we're using. It's infant, it does a couple of quick hacks.
So right now it's get it to a point where it's usable, and when everybody's happy that it's usable, we'll push the patch, right? That you'll push the patch?
Yeah. I was praying some Google Summer of Code soon would be quite interested in doing this project.
Yeah. U-boot maintainer Tom.
Yeah, that's the goal. And as soon as 4.11 RC1, I actually have two patches for you, green wireless and black wireless. Because they're going to go mainline. So on the kernel side, the mainline kernel for this board is actually really good. The blue hasn't been pushed yet because it hasn't been released. X15 is pretty good.
I mean, if you're doing static DTB, because really that's the only thing you need for U-boot. Like going back to U-boot, the only thing you need out of main that's not in mainline is overlays for capes. Yep. If you're doing a static DTB, mainline U-boot works fantastic. Now you've got a crazy script to try to do by default that you patch in to kind of boot from all sorts of different sources.
And a lot of that's compatibility for images 3 years ago. So for mainline, that doesn't matter. Because the first thing we do in our U-boot patch, we actually do the xcon Linux option. So if it doesn't detect that, it goes in a crazy scriptlet. So.
Is there a point where maybe we can drop that legacy part and just be doing the normal generic distro boot?
Considering I got another patch for 3.8 last week, probably never. But for the average user, mainline U-boot works fine.
I know whenever I'm, you know, doing any development, I just go back to mainline. I if I'm doing any changes to U-boot, want to see it, if I'm recompiling, I don't apply the patches and then move forward. I just go to mainline and then move forward. And I've never had any problems getting the kernel to boot and everything to work. Mike. Okay. Recorded.
The question, who is the currently maintainer kernel for the BeagleBone board?
Robert is the maintainer for the kernel for the BeagleBone board. So
okay. Robert, you want to talk from this and I can carry around the microphone?
Here's a question. I tried to build like a plain vanilla kernel from for a BeagleBone port, so I'm configured for ARM processor, bring up the SOAP modules, and it's never worked. So what did I do wrong?
Which def config did you use? Mainline OMAP2 def config will boot the board just fine.
Oh, it is?
And multi, I think, works too. I just don't do it on my build farm. I know OMAP2 works out of the box.
Okay, thank you.
And so you were doing something other than that, so first thing to try, right? That's... You have something to go try, right?
Yes.
Okay. Tony.
So, what kind of kernel patches do you still have? What's the diff stack currently compared to the mainline kernel?
It's getting smaller.
What do you have?
The main
PRUs and what else?
Yeah, the PRU still is a mainline for our situation. I know
UIO is mainline, but we're trying to move forward with remote proc since that's what we're understanding is the direction from the kernel maintainers is the remote proc is the way to go.
Yeah, our biggest patch set is still Pentaler's Kate Manager. Other than that, it's just hot fixes.
There's a couple little drivers, the ECAP.
Yeah, the ECAP driver, the X15 2D acceleration patch, which didn't get in quite yet. We gotta wait for some hardware mod clock changes before that can go back in. So,
and that's pretty much it, right? Is there anything else that we have out of mainline?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. There's a couple boards. The blue, of course, isn't on there. Black wireless got merged.
But the blue is using a Wi-Fi driver that's already mainline. So it's really just DTB and what else is actually in the kernel? Is there anything else in the kernel?
Yeah, just mostly device tree patches.
Yeah, I mean, we need to clean up our mainline device tree, right? Because we are one of the few boards that is that are supported by mainline device tree. So our device tree's there. I don't want to lose that status. It's a nice place to be.
And then a lot of our patch set too is different modifications like board default EMMC, board default video, board default audio, all the different 1,000 combinations you can have. And so those won't ever go mainline, but. But users want options.
Yep.
I've been trying to get hold of an X15 for quite some time.
Did we seriously go 32 minutes before that came up? Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Whew. All right. X15 will happen. I'm being recorded this time, I'm answering. Ask me again when I'm not being recorded. We're transitioning the manufacturers, and we're still trying to get the new manufacturer going. They really just want to try to get as many orders consolidated from distributors as possible so that they can have the lowest price, right? And it's been a little bit of a chicken and egg in doing that transition. The guys are still learning how to work with the different distributors. Most of the recent months have been just getting them set up in the system for all the distributors to place their orders. But they haven't gone out and really started doing the builds until they get the orders in. But all the major distributors are still on board and are putting orders in. The guys building it are waiting for that PO. Actually, when I originally booked ELC. My thought was, I'm finally going to have X15, so I have to go to ELC. right? Because, I mean, we pretty much built the X15 for this crowd, and I don't have it. So believe me, that's not more painful for anyone than me.
You do have it for tomorrow.
Oh, yeah, we brought one to show. We've gone through. It's passing FCC, so the long-winded fight of getting through FCC is done. That's not an issue anymore. We're making a transition from PG 1.1 to PG 2 silicon because by the time we got around to actually building it, the PG 1.1 silicon wasn't even available anymore. So we're moving to a processor update. So when it does release, it's going to be called revision C. But it is happening. We're essentially the 10 weeks out from the when the distributed orders all get placed, which is imminent. It's kind of a checking day to day thing. So I would estimate it at about 3 months.
But on the bright side, there's less bugs.
we've had user contributions of 2D of open source 2D graphics acceleration and
OpenCL. I mean, it's going to be a nice box out of the box.
Any news on upcoming hardware for this year, including anything from Octavo?
The new hardware. What's
probably the blue.
Oh, is there any new hardware this year? The BeagleBone Blue is imminent. The information, we don't really have permission to share the information that we're sharing here about the details of the BeagleBone Blue. But you know, we try to work very open in our community, and you know, hope to ask for forgiveness later on. But so that there's that is going to be coming soon, and we'll have some demos actually out at the showcase.
And that's going to be in March timeframe as actually a product.
I wasn't going to say, but
okay.
You know, if any of you are in Germany, you know, next month, you know, I'd pay attention around that timeframe. Yeah, that's the city. Anyway, there is more stuff coming. We're interested in some other things doing with the Octavo SIP, doing some other fun things with that. There's a gentleman here who's done a community hardware project. It's not an official BeagleBoard project, but I think it's really interesting because it's I'd started a hack called the PocketBone last year, and it was done in Eagle. So you know, a lot of people really want hardware developed with open source hardware tools like KiCad, and so he's taken the PocketBone design, re-implemented it in KiCad, did a real layout. He added a couple layers to try to get signal integrity on the USB that I'm not too worried about, but that's okay. It's four layers versus two layers is not too bad, but now it fits inside the mini Altoids 10. You really pretty simple. I mean, because you throw a couple crystals down, some resistors. There's even room for some buttons, and it's got a couple USB connectors on it. Got some assembled units coming March 8th. So we'll find out then exactly if it works. And you know, we're running this as a very much an open community project, and we're pretty excited about that. I think that Michael's even going to try we're going to commit you to that toaster oven assembly.
That's one of the things I'm excited about. So the pitch, we had one picture there with the BeagleBone Black Wireless, but if you look at Octavo Systems website, you'll see a picture of the system in package, and it's a huge pitch for the balls, which should be large enough that it should be manageable for a skilled electronics hobbyist or engineer to be able to hopefully use a stencil with solder paste in a reflow oven at home or in their lab, be able to do it on their own. So I don't think anyone's actually quite done that yet, but hopefully Michael will be one of the first people to do that and show that it's possible to actually assemble your own BeagleBone clone at home.
So you tried assembling the Octavo SIP onto a board with a toaster oven? There you go.
I did a two-layer board similar to the Pocket Bone, but a little bit different, and it didn't power on at all. So I made
it didn't power on at all. So.
Take the mic away.
If you copied mine too close, which I hope you paid attention to the GitHub issues list, I actually swapped the placement of a couple of crystals.
And, I don't think I followed yours at all, actually. It was just... kind of similar.
Oh, so you didn't start from my
I went through the
schematic.
The Octavo page of here's what to try to do. And I made the 7 external connections between the balls because I'm assuming it's something I did wrong with the PMIC or it's maybe my reflow didn't work. But I ordered another one, so I put about $150 in it.
Yeah.
When I get home from this, I'm going to try to reflow the other one and see if it works.
Okay.
It's... I got a stencil from Osh Stencils. I got a board from Osh Park. Yeah. So hopefully it'll work once I get back from ELC.
So how many more colors of epoxy do you think you get
actually? There's really not much of an end. Now you get to the different colors. It's kind of hard to read the silk screens, but there's a lot of colors in the rainbow.
So as far as layers go, because I'd like to try that as well, I don't know if it'll be a Pocket Bone or, and you're saying more than 4 layers. What are the other 2-layer designs of the lineup? I mean, what's realistic for us to create?
So with the SIP and with the AM335, I'm not aware of anybody that's gotten a 2-layer board completely functioning. So 4 layers seems to be the fewest anybody's got. So the BeagleBone Blue design prototype, I don't know what I could say, but it's to make it less official. But that's 4 layers, and it passes FCC, and we're good on 4 layers. I've had a number of people using it for a few months now, and seems to be rock solid. So it's a question, how few layers can you do?
Well, I have a Volterra printer that prints silver traces, so I can't do sandwich epoxy stuff. I can't do more than 2 layers.
USB is really the biggest concern in terms of traces on there. It's the highest speed signals that come off. You could do 6 mil traces and 6 mil spaces and route 2 traces in between the balls if you can get the spacing right in the design. So there's room for that. Should probably just use a thin PCB and put a plane on the other side. So don't use a full thickness FR4 board, but if you can get one of the ones that's a thinner board, you can probably get the the sort of signal integrity that you're looking for. I would just say you probably don't want to do the full thickness just because it's too far, the ground plane would just be too far from your traces. I think it's going to work fine. You keep the traces nice and close together. They're going to have a return path. The single-ended signaling isn't all that fast compared to the differential signaling. I think it's going to be fine, but my board didn't work, so...
Not really, I haven't finished yet, I just use a 4-layer board because that's what I'm kind of spoiled. I've been doing printed circuit boards for a while now. And
I get the mic a little closer, it's a little quiet.
Oh, so yeah, that's just what I'm used to is having the 2 plane layers, and it's what is really recommended for USB routing. You can get away with it, but I felt bad trying to sneak the pin between the pins. Especially with the BGA pattern that we currently have in KiCad, it's actually not quite getting 2 tracks between the pads because they're a little bigger pads. You can tweak the pattern if you want to try that. To me, it's kind of triggered my OCD a little bit, and I just went ahead and routed it in four layers. I do actually have, if you look at the history in my repository, I did get it to route in two layers. It has a slightly different layout. So if you want to go back and look through my KiCad repository, there is a routed version that uses two layers. I don't know if it'll work or not. So there's that.
On mine, I literally spent, I think it was about 3 hours, right, between like part creation and like grabbing things and actually like, you know, running the USB traces and clicking auto route. Yes. So not trying to claim it was a quality design, right? So when it didn't work, I shouldn't be too surprised. That's why I was really happy to see Michael picking that up and doing a quality layout. And my strategy at this point is let's see his work, and then I'd come back and strip it down to two layers and try again.
Hi. I was wondering how viable was it to just put a BeagleBone in a commercial product?
So it's extremely viable. A lot of people do it. That is not my endorsement. There's liability issues when you come to making consumer electronics and you don't actually validate it for your application in a real way, right? And that's true if you build off of a BeagleBone, you build off of a Raspberry Pi, you build off of any off-the-shelf board that doesn't have an engineer at the company claiming that it's suitable for this particular purpose. And it's almost impossible for us to do that without having some sort of customer engagement. And guess what? I don't do that anyway, right? There are other companies that go and do that. So I know people that will... will help you validate use of BeagleBone in a product. And I know a good number of people that do that. We don't have any restrictions. I know that Gerald's come out on the list a lot saying that just don't do it. There's no legal restriction for it. But there is a disclaimer from our part that we're not responsible if you go killing somebody because you made a defibrillator and it wasn't screened for ESD. The first time you shock somebody, the board blew up. It's viable. I know that a number of people just buy them off the shelf, and a number of people do derivatives. Right? It's been a I think it's helped build a lot of business for TI, and it's been a very successful processor, and I think in good part to the Beagle, right, and the ability, what that does to simplify people being able to get to market on their own. So very much want people to prototype with it before you go into production. Think about what you're doing, right? You should get an engineer to think about it. Don't think you're going to do things without an electrical engineer when you're making commercial electronics.
Thank you.
I think we have 3 minutes left if anyone has any final burning questions. Oh, I'm back there.
For 3 minutes, maybe you could just, if you could recap, you talked about Debian upstreaming and you talked a little bit real quick off mic. If you could just talk that through a little bit more.
Sure. As far as the delta with Debian right now, a lot of the patches in the Jesse image were just backports of Stretch. Basically, we needed a good desktop, and LXQT was, the one we'd use in Wheezy was pretty much going end of life, so we needed something. And the goal was if we use QT, there's a chance we might get SGX graphics working. That didn't work, of course, but so that's why we went LXQT route for this last image. But almost everything's in Debian now. There's still some things missing. I mean, we still have our U-boot patches of our own, but.
I mean, there's also a collection of just kind of like random utility packages that we have. I think there's the Ylink firmware package, mm-hmm. That is kind of oddball, and we've had some complaints about it. But in terms of we're going to make the changes to try to make it easier for that to be a main package. I know stuff like there are several that just pull down GitHubs and just repos and builds them, like the Cloud9 IDE.
We have three documentation packages. You know, they just pull in an image file that loads up on the user's desktop. So I know Debian would not ever accept that.
So there are, you know, a few oddball packages that are really just, you know, ways to trigger install scripts.
Are there any BeagleBoard specific packages that you've created that you've successfully pushed into Debian?
Would you have an idea maybe what some of those might be?
Because I've got like the PRU stuff, support stuff.
We still need that work in mainline though. That's the big problem.
Okay.
Because we're transition. I mean, the UIO driver is in mainline. It supports the L138 out of the box, but the PROS version 2, TI wants to push remote proc. So while the community is using UIO, yeah, we're stuck in a hard place right now.
And things like the compiler, there is a GCC compiler, but we still ship with the TI compiler that's covered under a freely redistributable license. The Debian package for that, for example, it triggers a script that downloads the package from TI and then runs the TI installer. Does that make sense to go put into a real Debian package? I don't know. Things like we've got some utilities that we put on just like opt sources, things like a Beagle tester, right? So there's we're trying to do more to share the ability to replicate our testing, our hardware testing, so that people could use that when they make their own variants of the boards. So there's a package called Beagle tester.
If you plug in a USB scanner for 2D barcodes and something pops up, you just found something cool. Yeah, the Beagle tester goes off a USB scanner. So if the screen changes all of a sudden, you just discover the test script.
Yeah, it's a UDEV role, triggers the test script.
But embedded in that is a whole production programming thing, so you could have a lot of fun with it.
Cool.
Patch is welcome there, more things to test.
Yeah.
So I did actually get Debian installer support working on the BeagleBoard X15, but I get the impression the model I have is of a relatively small number in production, and the new U-boot images may not work.
Is yours an A1 or an A2?
I think I got you an A2, and that would be okay. Fine. It's not going to be an E.
So my question was basically, should I pull that support for Stretch, or is that useful enough if people get the RevC or whatever? Is that going to catch fire if they try and use it?
There was about 200 or 300 of the A2s actually sold in Europe, so there is 200 to 300 of those boards out in the market right now.
Okay.
So they exist.
All right.
And the A1s are the only ones we say burn with fire and get rid of. Talk to your TI contact and get replaced ASAP.
Sure. So I'll leave it in.
Yeah, it's all good. That'll work. I know when we go to production again, there'll be the B revisions.
C.
Or C revisions.
Because
now.
It's PG. Gerald wants to up it because we went from PG 1.1 to 2.0. The board is the same as the RevB, but because the processor revision changed, he wants to call it RevC.
So what do we do with the mainline file? Because it's revision B in mainline right now.
Patch it.
So the most likely difference between Rev B and Rev C is going to be that we'll want to have a new U-boot because there will be new I/O delay magic that needs to be applied for optimal functionality. But that is
because
most
it is
likely
a,
to be it.
Because it is a different piece of silicon, it will have a different I/O delay parameter set.
Yeah, so when the time finally comes, it will be time to say, well, we need to update U-boot to whatever one has the correct I/O delay information for that silicon as well, but everything else really should be the same.
And from a board level standpoint, it should all be the
same.
Yeah,
so loading the RevB DT should be fine, and I think that is normal best practice, that we won't need to introduce a new named device tree until have a...
We saved ourselves some work.
But there's I/O delay timings in RevB right now.
Is that in the device tree, though?
In our version, it is. I don't think mainline has it yet. But
All right, maybe a little more to sort out, but yeah. if you have to push IO delay information up in the device tree, then yes, you will need to have one for Rev B and one for Rev C, and we'll have to do the runtime detection to say do this or that. And oh well.
So how many Rev Bs do we ship?
Zero.
Oh, we're good then.
All right, I think unfortunately we have run out of time for this Birds of a Feather, but we all three of us will be around through the end of the conference. We have a showcase and two talks tomorrow, and now you know what we all look like, so feel free to come up to us and talk about anything Beagle. I have some Beagle stickers up in front if you want to grab any on your way out, and thank you for coming.